Welcome everyone, welcome to the session on operations management. In this session we will discuss about decision making process in operations management. What are the different types of decisions the different levels of management are most likely to take? In any decision making process, from a set of alternatives given, how are you going to choose a particular alternative and stick to it so that you achieve your objective? One basic function of management, as you already understood from your previous sessions, is the planning phase. The planning is defined as determining the course of action, and in the planning function, how you are going to take a decision based on a specific problem, how you are going to solve a particular problem and make the task of arriving at a right decision. That is, both from your individual point of view as well as from the point of view of the organization. How are you going to solve the problem? Problem solving, one. When do we say there is a problem? When what you have set to achieve and what is actually happening are not matching. You have a certain objective of, say, making a sales of, say, 10 tons of a particular product by this month end. At the end of the month, you see that you've only made 5 tons of sales, which means you're falling short. That means you are under a problem. If what you set to achieve and what you have achieved till now, if it does not conform, your plan and your actual execution, if it does not match, then you say there is a problem. Now, what decision making are we talking about now? We are talking about specific decisions which relate to specific problems. So, one major classification of decisions is strategic decisions, which you can see on the slide here. These are the decisions concerning the long range production strategies. We have seen that every organization has different levels, most important being the top level, which comprises mostly of the promoters or the chief executive officer, general manager, president, etc. Not necessarily in that same order, but usually in organizations the designations may vary: president, chief executive officer, or the chief financial officer, chief general manager, correct. In the middle management, middle level managers, your people in charge of, say, the regional sales managers, for example, or the deputy general managers, deputy production manager, etc. at the middle level. And finally, at the lower level or the bottom level, you have the work supervisors, fresh engineers who have joined the organization, the scheduling people, the people on the shop floor, lab technicians, an educational institution. You can see the top will be the management, the top level will be the management and the principal of the institution. In the middle level, it will be the individual departments where you have HODs, senior professors, etc. And the lower level, the bottom level here, represents the lab technicians, the faculty and all the related office administrative staff who actually take a small part in the decision. Small here doesn't in any way, the lower level here in any way does not reflect the capabilities or competence levels of taking or of taking decisions. All are equally important for organizations. All the three levels, these levels, top, middle and level, are classified only based on the hierarchy, the positional levels, right? Each individual, each worker in an organization is equally important. His or her contribution is equally important to the organization, and even the top management acknowledges this, correct? So be very clear, when I say lower level of management, it means based on the hierarchy. Right? So these strategic decisions which concern long range production operations are usually taken by the top level of management. Some examples could be deciding about launching of a new product development project. A new product has to be launched. A new product has to be launched. Now, who will take a decision on this? The top level. The strategic decision, it's a strategic decision taken by the top level of management. Say introduction of a new course, new branch in an engineering stream in an engineering college or any college, for example, a new course or a new curriculum, revising of the curriculum, of course, based on the inputs of the entire organization, who is going to take a decision finally? The top level. The top level of the principal, the top level, who could be the management, right? So these are some of the examples of strategic decision. Introducing a new product into a new environment, for example, extending my borders outside India, for example, no, going out of your domain into a new area, exploring new avenues, etc. Who will take a decision? The decision will be taken by the top level. Deciding on the design for a production process, in addition to the product development, also deciding on the design for a production process, a process design, whether it should be, say, again, we have discussed about the different production processes, job shop, based on what are the setup required, what is the installation, what is the, I require installation, I require land, I require a land first, then on that land I have to know, build a factory or a layout where I can have machines. These machines need to be procured and they come at a cost. Now, what is the design required? You cannot go for an outdated technology. The technology should be upgraded, and we require a production process which is automated, which is in tune with the current requirements. So the design of a production process for a new product is also important. The people who design it may be different, but whether to go for that new design or not, who will decide? The top level. The top level will decide on that. Similarly, on how to allocate scarce resources such as materials, machine and labor capacities and utilities. Deciding on how to allocate scarce resources such as materials, machine and labor capacities and utilities. That is another very important strategic decision which the top level will make. Deciding on the new facilities, facility location, for example. If I have to now introduce or add a new warehouse or a new storage facility, say in your college, if tomorrow there is a proposal for a new swimming pool or a new academic section, correct? So who will take a decision on the top level? So only the faculty, the students and the individual departments can just give inputs, but who will be the final authority to take decisions? The top level and the principal, the management and the principal. So the top level of management here refers to the people in terms of hierarchy at the top of the pyramid. Next, what are the operating decisions that I'm talking about? The decisions must help to resolve the issues concerned with the planning production. So these decisions must help to resolve the issues concerned with the planning production. Yes, I have decided that I'm getting into a new venture. I'm extending my borders outside India. Yes, a strategic decision. But now once I extend, once I go and start my particular operations there, I need to take some decisions for the operating part. So what is that? Planning production. I have to plan production. Who will do that? The middle level. The middle level will now devise a plan to meet the customer demands for products and services. From the organizational point of view, yes, who will set the different types of a timetable? If I'm talking about an educational institution, yes, we have now started the new semester. Who will take decisions on the timetable? Who will decide upon how the labs should be held? Who will decide upon the rules and regulations? The individual departments will formulate. They will decide upon who will handle which subject, which faculty to be allocated to which subject, and so on. So these are the operating decisions. Decisions which the middle level, the HOD takes, department takes at the middle level of management. So this is the operating decision which I'm talking about. Please identify, please understand the difference between strategic and operating decisions. I very clearly explained to you now what is operating decision. I will again read out. These decisions help to resolve issues concerned with the planning production to meet customers' demand for products and services and to achieve customer satisfaction at reasonable costs. What are the different examples which you can give? Deciding on how much finished goods inventory to be carried out for each product, that is how much goods inventory to be carried. I have a production schedule today. Yes, the strategic decision at the top level has told to add one more production line to cater to the increasing demand. But whether that production line which is sanctioned, erected and commissioned at my place is working according to what its requirement? Is it working according to its capacity? This is the operating decision which has to be taken. Deciding upon the next month's production schedule for producing the products. That's another example. I have to now decide the next month's production schedule for producing the products. Now, who will give me inputs? The inputs will be given by the salesperson, the production people. But who has to produce, who has to make the production schedule? That will be the middle level of management. So, that is another example. Deciding upon hiring of casual temporary workers for the next month, depending upon how much or what length my particular, what length of time horizon my production line will work, I will decide upon whether to hire extra people, I have to outsource people, or I can manage it with my own people. So this is another example of deciding about hiring of casual or temporary workers. So this is another example for decision making or an operating decision under operations management. Now, we have to keep in mind here, when I talk about all these things, decision making is, again, as I told you, there is a huge debate in management whether management is an art or science. So basically, decision making follows some scientific steps. Sometimes it works, sometimes it does not. But only experience will make you foolproof decision maker. There's nothing like a foolproof decision maker, but you will avoid the mistakes to a large extent if you actually follow your the past cases. There's a approach to management called as the case study approach, where you study previous empirical approach or case study approach, where you look at past cases, similar situations, past cases, such case has occurred before. How was it tackled? If you make a study of that, you will get plenty of inputs on how to work. Even though the situation, the time may be different, it had happened some 20 years back under different circumstances, the entire scenario, market scenario was different, economic scenario was different, the government was different, correct? The entire technology adopted was different, your process itself was different. But then how will you, but still, the essence of that particular problem solving techniques, this will not die. They might evolve over a period of time, there may be continuous improvement, there may be refinement, but once you study a case which has happened before, you can get lots of input from them. So these operating decisions and strategic decisions you leave, that is at the top level. These operating decisions sometimes are repetitive. Operative decisions are sometimes repetitive, and as you go down the hierarchy, when we come to the next one, the control decisions, they become more repetitive. Right? So as you go up, strategic decisions may be one of a kind. They may not be repetitive. They might be one of a kind, even sometimes unique. But as you go down, operating decisions, they are more, operative decisions are now more repetitive in nature as compared to the previous, that is the strategic decisions. Deciding upon the volume of purchase from each vendor. So deciding upon the volume of purchase from each vendor for the next month. How much I will decide, deciding about the volume of purchase. Again, I have a requirement. How much do I purchase from the vendor? I have to have a clear-cut idea. There's a very clear purchase policy. I have to devise a purchase policy, both in terms of the timing and volume. These are the two things which we look from the purchase department. One is the timing of the purchase, because you require something when you actually require. You cannot have something when the requirement is there. The supplier should not tell you that, no, wait for 2 days. You require it now. So there is something called as a lead time, which means the time from the first order to the time of the receipt of the material. You make an order right from that time to the receipt of the particular product at your end. The time between these two is a lead time. So deciding about the volume of purchase from each vendor for the next month. That is another example which we can give for operating decisions. Next we will see what are control decisions. These decisions are concerned with the problems in production, such as variations in labor output, that is productivity, that is a partial measure, variations in product quality, breakdown of production equipment, etc. Production and operations managers need to control poor worker performance, inferior product quality and excessive equipment breakdowns so that the profitable operation of the productive system is not affected. So what is of concern here? There is something goes wrong. You have to fix it. How do you fix it? And you require a decision of allotment. Who will be allotted that job of fixing? And the process of making that particular equipment work again, right? Some decisions require such type of thought processes. So these control decisions, one of the examples which we can give is the course of action about a department's failure to meet the labor cost target. As I told you, target of the labor cost target. We have set a labor cost target that so much of people, so much of expenditure on labor. I have to control that. How do I do that? I set an objective, and if I fail, next month I see that no, I have not actually increased whatever was said. My labor cost expenditure this month is more than what I did last month, then you have failed. Now, decisions regarding that, decision regarding labor cost standards for a new modified product design which is about to be taken for production, a new quality control acceptance criteria for a product which design has been changed. So these are some of the examples about frequency of preventive maintenance for key machinery or equipment. Now these discussions are called control. These decisions are control decisions. Control here refer to setting things right. How do I set things right? So these are the other types of decisions which we often frequently encounter. So there are strategic decisions, there are next operating decisions and control decisions. And of course, some of this might be under certainty. See, we can see here, most of these decisions, like if I do this, I will get this. So decision making classification also is done on three other levels: so certainty, uncertainty and risk. So if you know the probability of the outcome, then you say it is decision making under risk. You know the probability, I will be 90% successful, 10%, yes, that is a decision making under risk. Decision making under uncertainty, I have no assessment, I have no clue about what will be the outcome. There's no probability at all of something happening, correct? Which means there's no probability. Probability is zero, which means it's under uncertainty. Decision making is under uncertainty. What is decision making under certainty? You're 100% sure that this outcome is going to come. That is, you're very pretty sure of the outcome, what is going to happen if I take a particular course of action. Correct. You invest in a SB account in a bank. They have already decided on a standard interest rate. So you're sure if I keep it for this much of month, I'll surely get this much of returns. Correct. Under certainty, decision making under certainty. You invest in a particular bank under SB account. Correct. That is under certainty. Correct. But if it's under equity shares and the share market, which is under tremendous, it's very dynamic in nature. You don't know. You can only anticipate. You can only say, 90%, 20%, 30% success rate. Correct. You're not very sure about what is going to happen. You're taking a small risk there. That's decision making under risk. And under uncertainty, natural calamities, for example, totally under uncertainty. You're not very sure what will happen if you take a course of action. So that is decision making under uncertainty. So all these decisions which you are taking are based on different parameters, but from the operations point of view, we can broadly classify it as strategic decisions, operating decisions and control decisions. So these are some of the decision making or these are the different decisions that you are most likely to take, either when you tomorrow become managers or at the most, even say in our you talk about your informal life, for example, not your official, not, let us not talk about in organizational context. If I talk about your home, for example, house, for example, there may be some decisions which you take based on gut feeling, correct? Based on gut feeling. These decisions, if successful today, does not guarantee you success the next time. So there has to be a very structured way of looking at decision making. Correct? Gut feeling, intuition sometimes works. Guesswork sometimes does not always. It will never be a long-term a choice for you. It should never be a long-term choice for you. Decision making should be based on certain structured thinking. Hope this particular session has now given you some insights into the different types of decision making in operations management.